Chapter 14, Bridge of Sighs. After a good deal of complaints from Orphy, the goodbye's path crossed an old bent street sign marked The Highway of Bones and came to a ruined bridge, once called the Bridge of Sighs. The bridge was in disrepair and consisted mostly of tall, deformed statues, many of which were missing digits, limbs, and heads. "You know," said Pyridine, pointing out the sign to her daughter, "this used to be the Lover's Lane of Nottholm." They were beginning to feel a little uneasy until Otis smelled the faint aroma of barbecue skewered hog frog, a typical treat sold by vendors of Nottholm. "Do you smell that?" he said with renewed hype. "Yes, I think Orphy relieved herself off the carriage roof," said Pyridine. "No, not that," he replied, picking up speed, moving around fallen blocks as each remaining statue above animatedly turned to look down at them. Otis abruptly stopped the hearse at a rusty iron gate portioned between the mission walls. They could tell the city rerouted the sewage down the sloped trail. On the gate, it used to read Memento Mori, but sadly, the letters M-E in the middle of Memento Mori had fallen off, and the M in Mori was now dangling upside down, leaving it to read Mento Worry. "That's Latin for remember you must worry," Otis instructed to his daughter, "in case you should forget." An unusual statue stood above the gate on top of a wall, tipped over in a seating posture and raising its arm as if it had grappled something before. Otis jumped off the carriage and tried to open the locked gate. The strange figure sitting above them decided to speak. "That's a crime, you know." Otis turned around to his wife.
"What did you say, my amour?"
Otis's way of saying, "me amour." "It was the statue," she said with interest. "It spoke." "Oh, yes," said Otis, now observing the statue more carefully. "I forgot they do that here." The sculpture sighed. "There is nothing for us anymore. No one recognizes us. Only that we are made of stone." "I won't quarry with you about it," returned Otis, looking at it with big eyes. The figure twisted its head and exclaimed, "I bet you don't even know who I am." The three thought for a moment. Otis sat down and watched his daughter, who was cutting more webbing from her veil the spider produced. "I got it," Otis announced, clicking his fingers. "Sam Lucas, the actor." The figure shook its head despairingly. "Hardly a male minstrel," Pyridine corrected through the window. "Has a chin like Pauline Musters, or at least I hope you might be Pauline. I've been dying to meet you, but you seem taller than 23 inches. Still, with your slouch, you could be." "I beg your pardon," cried the statue, willfully tipping further. "Are you Mayette?" suggested Orphy. "The goddess who weighs us?" "Sorry, but not even close," remarked the sculpture, in a tone of defeat. "She's further down the road, without a head." "No wonder no one takes the highway anymore," mumbled Pyridine to her child. Soon after, Otis popped up from his seat and said with a shriek, "No, wait! I know who it is! I know it!" "Yes?" retorted the statue more directly. "Yes?" It leaned in, now face to face with Otis. "Teddy Bilbo, the lunatic." "No," commanded the sculpture with an angry flash of her fading eyes. "If I had my scepter, I would stab you." Otis looked at his wife and shrugged. "Whatever happened to the times when people used to hold festivals in our honor?" the statue replied, catching Otis by the arm. "When people would give their last piece of bread for us." It sunk further, releasing him from its grip. "Have we grown so weak that no one remembers us?" "You are a bit of a slouch," Otis pointed out. "Have you tested for osteoporosis?" I would not doubt that, cried the statue, struggling frantically to stretch itself back up. I guess I have lost all my mineral wealth after all. The figure continued to sulk, while Otis sensibly pulled out his skeleton keys to test them on the gate. That'll never work, it called down, unless you have a membership. Can't we say we do? Otis grunted. Are you reciprocal with CHMA or the Funerary Directors Guild? Not anymore, it said, drawing back. You could try knocking three times. Otis rattled his knuckles painfully against the gate. But that won't work either, answered the stone creature in a meek voice. It was silly of me to suggest. Ghastly creature, said Pyrodyne. And no wonder the sewage drains here. You are certainly full of it. The figure drooped. Unfortunately, seeing how this is now a high-class establishment, I am not supposed to let just any unworthy souls, such as yourselves, walk in, particularly those who take the shortcut through the sewer. Not even if we take pride in being unworthy, said Otis truthfully. Surely that has to account for something. The statue stared crossly at the family. If you knew my name, you would obviously know a password. Go on, then. We won't wear it out. You have three minds, a horse, and a spider, snapped the statue. Put them to work. And we will have a hearse full of magflies, too, if we have to wait very long, demanded Pyrodyne. Waiting is my specialty. At least I have plenty of that, the statue said, turning slightly away. It was momentarily quiet as the sculpture peeked to see if they may have left. But as they had not, it said with a hint, I also am good at sewing. Do you like to sew? Certainly, said Pyrodyne. Sewing is one of my specialties. What do you reap? Asked the statue, believing she was speaking of sewing a garden. Is it radishes, celery, or olives? Not usually, unless they were in somebody's stomach at the time of death. As the two discussed sewing, or what they believed to be the topic, Otis thought if he were to send his hat over the wall, that somehow, between the hat and the flying trocar looking to retrieve it, that they could find a way to unlock the gate from the other side. It was a downright terrible idea, but much to the discredit of Otis. He threw his hat in the air, and the statue, which had dropped so low and weak, was smacked by the hat and shattered before Otis's feet. Crash, crumble. They were motionless for a time, and then Pyrodyne, who actually enjoyed the conversation, oblivious to the mix-up of sewing and sewing, let out an awful gasp. Otis felt horrible, but was at a complete loss for words. His mouth quivered, searching for the right thing to say. Oops. At this time, the iron doors flung freely open, and Pyrodyne, who was briefly distracted from scolding Otis, watched as he picked up his hat and the three anticipated what was behind the door. I guess that was the password, Orphy shrugged. A moment later, behind them, Frank Thorne rode through the gate and advanced directly to the tower.